Good morning. So good to see you. Thanks for being here today. This morning, I invite you to come to the Lord who is rich in grace and to approach our God who is full of mercy. And will you this morning praise God with all your heart and glorify the name of the Most High? Will we? Let's do. Would you stand with me? Him, and I'm going to recite some things that Jesus has done and who he is in our lives, and I want you to respond after each phrase with, "We worship you, Lord." Instead of the joy meant for him, he endured the cross, disregarding its disgrace.
We worship you, Lord.
O Jesus Christ, born in humility, to confound the proud and to raise the humble.
We worship you, Lord.
You lived among us, helping and healing the sick, proclaiming good news to the poor and freedom to prisoners.
We worship you, Lord.
And you came to unbind the chains of every slavery, O friend of the humble, bread of hungry hearts.
We worship you, Lord.
And Jesus, full of patience and goodness, you showed forgiveness and kindness to the very end.
We worship you, Lord.
Jesus, you came into the world to serve and to give your life. You were betrayed for money and dragged before judges and nailed to a cross.
We worship you, Lord.
Let's worship him.
Beneath the cross of Jesus,
from the burning of
before the Lord with the only thing that is acceptable in His sight is a broken spirit. It says in Psalm 51, a broken and contrite heart, O God, You will not despise. And so let's pray this prayer of confession as we stand before a holy God. Pray it with me. God, we make so many mistakes. We turn away from You so often. We need You so much. Please forgive us. Thank You that You so love the world that You sent Jesus to die on the cross to save us from our sins. Amen. And then from Ephesians, let's pray this as an assurance and pardon. By grace we have been saved through faith, and this is not our own doing. It is a gift of God. Amen. Thank You, God. You may be seated.
Come on. Amen. Jesus does indeed bring us rest. Amen. Amen. Thank you for leading us, choir. Today we are welcoming 12 new members into our church, both here at the 9 a.m. and the 10:30 service. And one of the beautiful things about church membership and being the body of Christ together is that we all have a story. We all have a journey. We all have ways in which God is working in our life and has worked in our lives. And those stories all come together in the body of Christ. They come together in the church. And people at different moments, at different times, going through different things, come together and worship Jesus. And that is just a real beautiful thing about being part of the church. And so we're so excited to welcome new members here this morning, also at the 10:30 service. And one of the things that we've wanted to do was to share some more stories, share some stories of people who have joined the church, and to hear what God has, how God brought them, and what God is doing in their lives now. And so Rob and Nora Brooks recently became members at Trinity this past year, and they put together a couple-minute video just sharing their story, sharing their journey a little bit. So let's go ahead and watch this video of Rob and Nora.
Hello, Trinity. This is Rob and Nora Brooks. We had actually been attending Trinity for a couple years, several years back. And it was one of those stories where life kind of gets in the way and you find excuses of why not to go, kids' events, different things. And so we had strayed for a little bit and we're trying different churches. And then COVID hit and we had lost some family members and we're just like, we need to make a commitment to a church. And we were thinking about which ones we had been to and which one we wanted to try again. And we're like, you know, let's try Trinity. Let's give it a few months, commit to it for a few months and see how it goes. We came back that first Sunday and we walked in and we knew that this was the place. We didn't need to wait a few months. We just knew from the greeting that we got, from people remembering us, people just welcoming back that we were home.
We belong to the Wednesday Night Life group. Being in a group for us has been the best way to just feel a strong sense of belonging. Everybody was welcoming when we came in, when we went to church, but when you're with a group, you're with the same people and you really get to know them a lot better rather than just chatting with somebody quickly on a Sunday morning.
Like Nora said, the Wednesday Night Life group, it's not just that, it's the involvement and the energy of the whole church. I mean, you come in and it is the best midweek pick-me-up that I can even imagine anywhere, from the Awana kids to the other studies. I mean, it's complete fellowship. It's not just with your group. There is a fellowship within all of the walls of this building that is just amazing. For us specifically, becoming a member, it was more for us in our commitment, because the entire time we have been attending since we came back in that first time, we never felt like we weren't a member. We always felt like we were part of the Trinity family, but this was more our way of saying thank you, we're in. Accountability kind of seems like a word that has a lot of different meanings, but it's nice because it does add a sense of accountability. If it's like, you know, I don't really feel like going tonight or on Sunday or whatever, but there's a whole different sense of, you know, no, I made this commitment to God, to the people in our groups, to the church, we're going to be there. And that was what we were missing when we would watch online and we would kind of just justify it as that way. Well, we've gone to church. Well, we hadn't gone to church. And it's really the people, the pastors, the service, everything about the presence on a Sunday or on a Wednesday that really takes us specifically over that hump. And I think it would for anyone else as well, to just be in the presence of God and the people.
Yeah, you can give him a round of applause. Yeah. Love that. I love their comments just about the importance of people. And it's really the relationships, the knowing one another, the growing together, the following Jesus together, being in God's presence together. That's what the church is about. And they just articulate that so well. So thankful for them. And next part is we have some more people that are going to join our church. And so I'm going to ask those in the front who are going to become members, if you guys can go ahead and stand. We'll do some vows. And if you affirm these vows, you can say, I do. So they're making commitment to God and the church. Then in a minute, I'm going to ask you all for a commitment to them as well. So we kind of have a two-way commitment going on here. And so if we could put those vows on the screen. There we go. First one. Do you believe in Jesus Christ and trust him as your Lord and Savior?
I do.
And do you desire to join Trinity Church in its life and mission to the world, promoting its unity, purity, and peace, sharing your gifts and life with us as we share our gifts and life with you? Amen. You guys can go have a seat. You can have a seat. And then a question for the congregation. This is for all of us. This is, you can say in the affirmative, we will. So this is the question to us. Will you, Trinity Church, warmly welcome these believers into our family of faith, sharing your lives with them as they share their lives with you, seeking together to grow in the grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ?
We will.
Amen. So one of the last things I want to do for those of you who just joined is give you guys just a really brief just charge as you're coming in as new members right from the get-go. And so it is a verse from Micah chapter 6, one that is a familiar passage perhaps, and it says this. It says, what does the Lord require of you? It says, to act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. So my charge for you all as you join Trinity Church is to act justly, seek the good of our neighbors, seek the good of our community, to love mercy, to love people in our church when it's hard to love them, when it's difficult to love them, in good times and bad times, love them with the mercy of God, and to walk in humility, knowing that we need God and we need one another. Amen? Amen. So I'll go ahead and say a word of prayer, and then we'll move on in our service here. Dear Lord, thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity to welcome these new members into the Trinity Church family, Lord. We pray that we would be churches continually led by you, our good shepherd, and that we would just have a humility and an earnestness to seek you and your ways in all things. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. Welcome to Trinity. We are so glad that you have chosen to worship with us this morning. If you are a guest today, or maybe you've been checking us out for a few weeks and you haven't said hello to us yet, we would love to meet you. Come stop by the Connect desk after service. Fill out that Connect card that is in your hand this morning. It's attached to your bulletin. We want to say hello to you. We want to give you a free gift just for being here. And of course, we want to help you get connected in the days to come. Come see us. I just want to celebrate with all of you this morning. I'm sitting right now in our Trinity Kids large group room. This room gets filled on Sunday mornings with all of our kids worshiping Jesus, learning scriptures. On Wednesday nights for Awana, it is packed in here. Kids are getting in the scriptures. Kids are being mentored by great volunteer adults, but I want to celebrate because I'm told that there's some kind of revival happening in our first graders. We've had 6 or 7 first graders say yes to the Lord. They're saying, yes, I want to know what it means to follow Jesus. I want to receive him into my heart, and they are coming alive with Jesus. So celebrate with us in that. Thank you, parents. Thank you, ministry leaders. God is moving here at Trinity. And speaking of kids, this Saturday, March 23rd, is our Easter extravaganza. You do not have to sign up. Just show up at 10 o'clock. Be here on time. All of the egg hunts will have a time slot, and you won't want to miss any part of it. But the real goal for that day, the real goal is that kids and families would get into the building, feel the love of Jesus and start asking questions about what it looks like to follow Christ and to give their whole hearts to Him. Let's go for Saturday. We've got a couple of awesome opportunities happening after Easter. Of course, Alpha Course is coming up on April 3rd. You want to grab one of these invites for those in your life who you think would like to ask some really great questions, have dinner together. What is life all about? Why is there so much pain in the world? These are great questions to ask, and we want to give you guys the opportunity to invite people into this. Now listen, maybe you're the one having these questions. We just were invited a couple weeks ago by Pastor David to think about what are we wrestling with God about, all of those really hard things. We can go to Alpha after Easter. You guys, this is for you as well. Get signed up for Alpha now. And maybe you want to grow in gratitude. Pastor Mark has a course coming up after Easter as well called the Gratitude Adventure. Make sure you email him and let him know you want to be part of this class on Wednesday nights as well. There's only 35 spots, so let him know you want to be a part of that. Grow in gratitude. Learn what it means for our brains scientifically, physiologically, and spiritually to be filled with gratitude. Prime time is this Thursday. This is our retirement ministry. Listen, if you want to get to know new people, you just want to hang out, be encouraged, come this Thursday. Everyone is welcome. You don't even have to be retired to come. Just come and enjoy time with lots of new friends. But listen, this Thursday, it's all things pie. So come eat some pie, lots of pie. Be encouraged in the scriptures, be encouraged in friendship. Find out more in our app or in our bulletin. If you'd like to give today, you can do so very easily by going to that app or going online to our giving page. We are so thankful for your generous giving. You can also find our giving boxes in the gathering spaces this morning after service. Let's get back into our sermon series, Living with a Glorious Limp.
Well, good morning. If I haven't met you yet, my name is Mark, and I have the privilege of being one of your pastors. We had a great week. Last week, I wasn't here, but my wife and I were able to go to Florida on the Gulf side and just enjoy some warm weather, and that was awesome. So, but we were able to watch the service last week at 9 a.m., so that's we were joining with you if you were here. And I love the fact that a couple weeks ago in this series that we've been studying the life of Jacob, this guy who lived almost 4,000 years ago. And so on the one hand, you think, well, how is his life relevant to ours? How can we possibly learn from him? And on the other hand, as we've walked through his life, we've seen that there are so many different ways that his life connects with ours. His foibles, his growth, his faith, the ups and downs, the struggles, the joys, all the sorts of things that he does, we find ourselves connecting with him because we go through a lot of those same things. Our faith development is not straight line. It's not always up and to the right. It's always up and down. We struggle with the same sorts of things that he did. And so I love the fact a couple weeks ago we said, you know, there are some defining moments that each one of us have in our life. Defining moments where we wrestle with God about some significant issue. It's a job. It's something in our life that we're going through. It's a relationship. And your goal ought to be to lose to God. To hang to him in faith and allow him to bless you because he knows what's best for us. And then I love last week where Pastor David, at the end of the sermon, had an application for us as a church. And you see around the room different sticky notes. You were asked, like, what are some times that you're wrestling with God? What are some issues you're wrestling with currently? And then where's an issue that maybe you've surrendered to God in the past, you've wrestled and seen breakthroughs in your life. And I've just loved walking through the room this week, both here and in the Family Life Worship Center, to see hundreds of ways that you're wrestling with God and that you've experienced breakthroughs with God. And ironically, they're the same sorts of things. When I see what you're wrestling with issues of anxiety or it's relationships or it's jobs or in some cases even wrestling with whether God is real or if this is just a story that's make-believe that our parents tell us. And then ironically, when you're asked, like, where have you surrendered to God? Where have you wrestled with God and seen breakthroughs? It's the same sorts of things. Different people have experienced anxieties and depression or wrestling with God's existence or wrestling with jobs or vocational choices or relationship sorts of things and experienced different ways that God has moved in us. These are the testimonies of our church, that God is personal, that God is always faithful to us, that we wrestle with the same sorts of things, that we're in this together. And I love that, don't you? Amen? So today, normally we read the scripture at the beginning of the service, in the middle of the service before the sermon, because we want to give pride of place to God's word, because it's God's word and we want to honor him and listen to his word. Today I didn't do that because the text of this morning is brutal. There are times as you're walking through the Bible that the great thing about going through the Bible chapter by chapter, book by book, is that that God gets to set the agenda. The Bible sets the agenda for us. The bad news about this is that the Bible sets the agenda for us, and sometimes there are issues that the text raises that I would rather not talk about. I was just yesterday at a conference with several of the men from the church, and Chad Bird, who wrote a book on the life of Jacob, was the main speaker. And I was telling him that we were doing this series, and he said, well, what are you talking about tomorrow? And I said, the rape of Dinah. And I said, what should I say? He said, good luck with that. So I wanted you to be able to hear a little bit first, because sometimes the Bible just depicts chaos, and it depicts the brokenness and brutality of life. And it's not doing that just to titillate us or to entertain us somehow, like a movie. It's helping us to see that there is this brokenness of humanity that we all experience. It's trying to drive us to understand this is who we are as human beings. This is why we need a Savior. I'm going to put a picture up on the screen. This is Sanibel Island last year, a year and a half ago, after Hurricane Ian came through. When Denise and I were down in Florida last week, we visited Sanibel Island. It's a 20-minute drive from where we were staying in Fort Myers. And we walked along the beach, and this was the most devastating hurricane on the Gulf cost-wise for 85 years. This is, when you go to Sanibel Island today, as we walked along the beach, they've cleaned up the trees for the most part, and the brush and boats that were laying on the land and that sort of thing, but condominium after condominium for miles, four-story, five-story buildings, dozens of occupants, they're gutted. They're either, the windows are broken out still, or they're just paneled over with plywood or whatever. It's devastation. This is what the Bible depicts in the story today. It's devastation. It's we're meant to see it, and we're forced, in a way, to look at it, because God wants us to see the brokenness of the world, so that he can help us to see why we need a Savior and why we need to understand his love. So let me read this story for us. And as you go, it may be difficult for some of you to hear. It may be triggering for some, and we'll talk through that. I want to just be cautious and pastoral. But let me pray for us first. But Lord, we ask now that you would give us the grace to hear what we need to hear today. Help us to learn what we ought to learn from this difficult passage. Teach us your ways. Keep us in your paths. Forgive us our sins. Grant us mercy when others sin against us. And open our ears, O God, today, that we might hear you speaking to us in the scriptures. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Amen. So if you want to open your Bibles, turn to Genesis 34. We'll have the words up on the screen. And this is the story continues in Jacob's life. And it says this. Now, Dinah, the daughter of Leah, the daughter Leah had born to Jacob, went out to visit the women of the land. When Shechem, son of Hamor the Hivite, the ruler of that area, saw her, he took her and raped her. And his heart was drawn to Dinah, daughter of Jacob, and he loved the young woman, and he spoke tenderly to her. It's brutal. It's almost a psychotic reaction that he has. And Shechem said to his father Hamor, "Get me this girl as my wife." When Jacob heard that his daughter Dinah had been defiled and his sons were in the field with their livestock, so he did nothing about it until they came home. In the Hebrew, there's actually, like, it almost reads in the English, like, because they were in the field, he just didn't do anything about it. In the Hebrew, there's just a continuation. This happened, and they were in the field, and he did nothing. Then Shechem's father, Hamor, went out to talk with Jacob. Meanwhile, Jacob's sons had come in from the fields as soon as they heard what had happened. They were shocked and furious because Shechem had done an outrageous thing in Israel by sleeping with Jacob's daughter, a thing that should not be done. And Hamor said to them, "My son Shechem has his heart set on your daughter. Please give her to him as his wife. Intermarry with us. Give us your daughters. Take our daughters for yourselves. You can settle among us. The land is open to you. Live in it. Trade in it. Acquire property in it." Then Shechem said to Dinah's father and brothers, "Let me find favor in your eyes, and I will give you whatever you ask. Make the bride price and the gift I'm to bring as great as you like, and I'll pay whatever you ask me. Only give me the young woman as my wife." Because their sister Dinah had been defiled, Jacob's sons replied deceitfully as they spoke to Shechem and his father Hamor. They said to them, "We can't do such a thing. We can't give our sister to a man who's not circumcised. That would be a disgrace to us. We will enter into an agreement with you on one condition only, that you all become like us by circumcising all your males. Then we will give you our daughters and take your daughters for ourselves. We'll settle among you, become one people with you. But if you don't agree to be circumcised, we'll take our sister and we'll go." The proposal seemed good to Hamor and his son Shechem. The young man, who was the most honored of all his father's family, lost no time in doing what they said because he was delighted with Jacob's daughter. So Hamor and his son Shechem went to the gate of their city to speak to the men of their city. "These men are friendly toward us," they said. "Let them live in our land and trade in it. The land has plenty of room for them. We can marry their daughters. They can marry ours. But the men will agree to live with us as one people only on one condition, that our males be circumcised as they themselves are. But won't their livestock and their property and all their animals become ours? So let us agree to their terms and they will settle among us." All the men went out of the city gate, agreed with Hamor and his son Shechem, and every male in the city was circumcised. 3 days later, while all of them were still in pain, two of Jacob's sons, Simeon and Levi, Dinah's brothers, took their swords and attacked the unsuspecting city, killing every male. They put Hamor and his son Shechem to the sword and took Dinah from Shechem's house and left. The authors withheld this from us. They've kidnapped her. They're hiding. They're holding her. They take her back. And the sons of Jacob came upon the dead bodies, looted the city where their sister had been defiled. They seized their flocks and herds and donkeys and everything else of theirs in the city, out in the fields. They carried off all their wealth, all their women and children, taking as plunder everything in their houses. Then Jacob, and this is the first thing that Jacob has said, Jacob said to Simeon and Levi, "You've brought trouble on me by making me obnoxious to the Canaanites and Perizzites, the people living in this land. We're few in number, and if they join forces against me and attack me, I and my household will be destroyed." But they replied, "Should he have treated our sister like a prostitute?" See, normally we say, "This is the word of the Lord," and you say, "Thanks be to God." It's hard, right? This is hard. If you come to the Bible and you're always looking for, assuming that you're only going to see good people in it, and we should imitate what the good people do, we read a story like this and we're like, "I don't know what to do. There's no good in this story." If you come to the Bible and you think, well, it's just going to give us a set of instructions. It's going to say, if there's this bad thing that happened, then here's how you should respond. We'll be disappointed because it doesn't give us those descriptions. It leaves all sorts of questions open. If someone were to, it makes us wrestle with the limitations of our humanness. It makes us wrestle with the evil that happens in this world, the confusion and the pain. What's the proper response to sexual violence? What should you do if a family member has something terrible happen to them? They're harmed and there's just no good options for punishing the wrongdoer. How do you exact justice in the absence of good possibilities that are commensurate with the offense? How do you create communities that are free and safe from rape or violence like this? It doesn't give us those answers. And so many times we prefer to not talk about passages like this, but I wanted to share with you today some insights maybe from this. But it's tricky. I know we have kids in here, teens in here. I mean, it's just a... But the Bible is an honest book. The Bible is a raw book. It's an earthy book. It sometimes is a hard-to-read book. It's filled with the good and the bad and the ugly. And today is mostly just the bad and the really, really ugly. there's two obvious atrocities in here in the story. And even in the text, it kind of helps us to see the bookends of the story, the badness in this. The first is obviously with Dinah. In verses 1 and 2, the words themselves help us to understand the bookends, because it said, Dinah went out and Shechem took her, the literal words. That's the first humiliation. Verse 25, at the end, Simeon and Levi, same words, took their swords and they went out against the men of the city. There's this idea that Dinah went out and Shechem took her, and then Simeon and Levi went out with their swords and took the life of the people. There's this parallelism that helps us to understand. This is the devastation that kind of frames the story. And then there are all these characters in between that help us to understand badness, how not to do things, and maybe there's something that we can see of how to live. And ironically, one of the characters that's not in this chapter is God. We see throughout Genesis, there are times when God is very present and he's meeting with people and he's appearing to people. And then there are also chapters where God's name is never even mentioned. And we actually are meant to understand in the midst of that, that this is probably how people felt, that God is not there in the midst of this. And this is how life is lived in humanity when God is not considered. It's Sanibel Island. That's the life that we give to ourselves. So at the risk of, no risk, there's always risk in preaching, but it's a challenge. I framed the ideas of each of these characters. I'm going to look at four different characters. I framed it as voices. What are the voices that we hear? And which are the voices that we should follow? Which are the voices we shouldn't follow? One of our shows that we like to watch several years ago, we haven't seen it much recently, is The Voice. How many of you are fans of The Voice? Or have been? 25 seasons it's made. That's actually amazing. I was looking at it this morning. The different judges that have been on there, there's 20 different judges. Because what you have happen, if you haven't seen the show, is there's a singer who is singing a song, and it's somebody that's unknown, and they're trying to win the approval of some celebrity judges. And you got four judges that sit up front, and they're in these chairs that back up to the singer, so they can't see the face and the actions of the singer. They can only hear the voice. And then if they really like the singer and the voice, then they can hit a button and they can turn, and then all sorts of goodness ensues. Blake Shelton was my favorite judge of all time. I don't know. Adam Levine is one of my favorites. Reba McEntire's on there now. Just these judges. And so I thought all these different voices are voices that when we hear these voices, maybe we turn to face them, or maybe we just don't. And so bear with me on this. Like I said, Chad Bird said, good luck with this text. So I'm doing my best. Shechem is the voice of violence. Shechem, this young man, it says in verse 1, Dinah, she went out and she was talking with the women of the land. She was visiting with them. Shechem, who is this guy who is a ruler, he's rich, he's in control, he's used to getting his way, saw her, took her, and raped her. And then the text tells us, like then, and this is so odd, his soul clung to her. This often is not what happens. Most of the time, there's a revulsion that takes place. But you can almost read this like he became obsessed with her. And it says he loved her. And then he spoke tenderly to her. And then he said, get this girl as my wife. He's the voice of violence. What an odd, deviant order of things. That he perpetrates this act of obscene violence and perverse exercise of power over her. Because that's what rape is. There's no affection involved. It's not love. It is perversity. And yet immediately after this, his heart is drawn toward her, and he falls in love with her. He defiles her, he humiliates her, he violates her, and then somehow in his sick mind he's drawn to her. As a father of a daughter, it's hard for me to repress the urge to go Jack Reacher on this guy. I don't even know Jack Reacher, but I don't know. Whatever. Look at the order of the verbs. He lies with her. His soul is drawn to her, he loves her, and he speaks tenderly. That's so backward of how this ought to be for us. if you're especially a single man, but this is true for each gender, that's exactly the opposite of how it should work in our lives. See, this is the order of things. When you're watching a television show, this is exactly what happens. The couple, they meet, they're attracted to each other, they always sleep with each other first. And then maybe you get to have affection for the other person. And then maybe get to know them a little bit, and then finally, if you ever get there in a TV show, there's tenderness and there's ongoing care and love for another person. That's the way it works in our culture. That's what we see all the time. That's exactly backwards of how it ought to be. Because in reality, the way that God has set it up for us is that we would meet somebody, that we would begin talking with people, we would begin to get to know them, we get to know their heart, we'd get to be, then we're drawn to them and we become attracted to them and bonded, and then we begin to fall in love, and then the what ought to happen is then we've connected together to such a level that there's a covenant commitment to be married to one another for life, and to bond one together, not just in our soul, but then with our bodies. But that's exactly the opposite of what our culture teaches us. See, when you listen to the devastation of the world, you see the response here of Shechem. You just get this backwardness of how relationships work. That's not how it ought to be. When we hear that voice, don't push the button. Don't turn. That's not the voice that God wants us to listen to. That's not the voice that brings fulfillment in life. That's the voice that brings devastation, that brings emptiness, that brings relational distancing. And Shechem is the voice we listen to in this story, and we don't go there. Amen? Mm-hmm. And then you get to the voice of Simeon and Levi, the voice of vengeance. If I were to listen to this music, it would sound like death metal to me. Because you get to them, and they find out what happens. These brothers are out in the field, and they find out that their sister has been devastated, and they're devastated in their heart for her because they care for her. And so fault them for wanting justice. You can't fault them for wanting to somehow rectify the situation. And yet they go about it in all the wrong ways. They're like their dad, in that their dad, the deceiver, always was deceiving people. And so like father, like son, they go to this family and they trick them and they deceive them. And they say, okay, so here's the deal. We agree, if you want to marry our sister, we'll go with that. But here's what you have to do. You have to be circumcised. And then they wait until the whole town gets circumcised. And then the post-op recovery, if you're squirming right now, the post-op recovery for an adult is pretty brutal. And so the two boys and their brothers go in with their swords and they wipe out everything. They just escalate the violence beyond the pale. They take all of their wives and all of their kids and all of their stuff, and they wipe out all of the men. They've taken a response that needed justice to avenge somehow the brutalization of their sister, but they brutalize who knows how many, dozens and dozens of families. It's an escalation. It's this voice of vengeance. We're supposed to see that and turn away and realize that's not how we ought to live. It's not how God created us. To take a situation that demands justice and to pursue it in ways that are inappropriate, that are harmful, that are beyond. And you think to yourself, I would never do that. What is this? How does this connect with me? I would not go if something bad happened and wipe out a city. And I hope that's true of everybody in this room. Because if it's not, we need to get the security team over here. But here's the thing. How about this story? This is an imaginary story. It's it's not my own family, but doesn't stuff like this happen? Dawn and David go to the grocery store. They're a married couple, and they come home, and they're putting the groceries on the counter, and David knocks over a vase, and it breaks. Accidentally, and Dawn has a real significant connection to that vase, and so she immediately responds with hard words. She raises her voice and she says, "What are you doing? Why do you knock things over all the time?" And he's defensive about that. And he says, well, fine, you know, you always do things right. And he uses sarcasm and it's hurtful. And so she responds back, "Well, you always are like this." And pretty soon their words are at each other's throat and tears and anger and yelling, and they leave, and two beds that get warm that night. Nobody's ever had that happen, right? We in our hearts can go down that road of just escalating. Something happens to us and our response is even stronger, the response, and pretty soon, Sanibel Island. And God's showing us a picture like this to say, when you hear that voice that says, I need to get even, resist that voice. Don't push the button on that voice. Amen? The third voice that we hear is the voice of Dinah. And I would call Dinah's voice the voice that can't be heard. It's the unheard voice. And I say that because Dinah is acted upon in this story in a way that is really uncomfortable for us. The story doesn't tell us anything about how she feels. She's mentioned once before this in the Bible when she was born, and she's not mentioned again in the Bible. This is her story, and she never speaks. This is her story. She's brutalized. She's traumatized. We don't know how she felt about it. We don't know who she was able to talk to. We don't know if she had friends. We don't know if she went to her dad and said, "Dad, this is what happened." We don't know how that happened. No one ever asked her opinion. The whole story is action around what happened to her, but she's never spoken to. She's never given a chance to voice her feelings. Nobody pays attention to her. She's invisible. One author said she's written out of history. And she's almost like she's erased as a person. She's utterly objectified. Now, the narrator of the story, the writer of Scripture, helps us to understand God's view versus the view of others, because she's named by the narrator. The narrator starts out and says, "This is Dinah, the daughter of Leah," and whenever it talks about her, from the narrator's perspective, she's named. She is Leah. She's personified. She's an individual. She is valued, and she's known. When she's talked about by everybody else, her father, her brothers, the others, she is the woman. Shechem says, "Get me that woman as my wife." The brothers even refer to her, she's the sister, she's our sister, she's the woman, she's the young woman. She's not identified, she's not personified, she's objectified. Denise and I had some long conversations this week about what might be helpful for me to say as your pastor, because she's a therapist, and in the last couple of years, she's begun to specialize more and more in trauma, and she's seen now dozens of young women or older women, primarily. It's not only a female thing, but it's primarily what she's seen. Women who have been abused, who've been, in some cases, raped, or have been subjected to physical abuse, sexual abuse, verbal abuse, emotional abuse at the hands of somebody else, and the trauma that they experience, the trauma that still they experience, that just sticks with you, is beyond the pale. And trauma just shatters. Her insight was helpful for me, because she said trauma just shatters a person's view of themselves. You come into this world and you're starting to grow up and you think the world is good and people are trustworthy, and then something happens and you're brutalized. And all of a sudden, Satan uses all sorts of lies to get into our head, to convince us of his ways and not God's ways. And when somebody is traumatized, the most common reaction is to pull back. It's avoidance. It's all of a sudden, the world is not safe anymore. I can't trust people. I thought the world was good, but the world is not good. And there's a pulling back that's hard to connect relationally. When you hear stories of somebody else's trauma, it triggers your own trauma. Even today, it's likely that just hearing the story of Dana, hearing me talk about it, is triggering emotions that are really, really strong in you. When they call it post-trauma distress, it's because you're sensing that trauma all over again. You're reliving it, and it causes you to sometimes act in ways that are not rational because you're only using half your brain because you're just responding in the moment. There's fight and flight. There's all those sorts of things that are going on because you've experienced this trauma. And in the midst of that, oftentimes when somebody tries to tell the story of what happened to them, there's try to work up the courage to actually confess to somebody else what happened. Those around want to believe the world is not like that. They want to believe that it's a good world and something like that couldn't happen. And so, because they don't want it to happen to them, because we want to feel safe. And so you subconsciously don't believe the story. You think, well, maybe something you did yourself. Maybe you kind of were dressed the wrong way, went to the wrong place, you had one too many drinks, and so that's why it happened. And suddenly you can't confess something because you're to blame. And that's the way trauma works, and that's the way our response works, and that's just devastating. And you can't imagine, I can't imagine what Dinah was going through, and nobody asked her what she's feeling. And if I could say anything, just as your pastor, I just want you to know if that's happened to you, I'm sorry that you've experienced that. I mean, I just, even this week, thinking about, talking about this was devastating to me. I'm sorry that that still deeply impacts you. I'm sorry that when you told your story, people didn't believe you. And those are the lies that Satan is telling you, that you're no good, that you can't trust people ever, you've got to pull away from people, that you are less than, that you are not lovable, that it's your fault. Those are lies from the devil. And I just know, like, if, because all of us have experienced trauma in different ways, and that can be significant or maybe less significant, but when I experience something bad, what I have to come back to again and again is Jesus knows what that's like. Jesus knows what it was like to be traumatized. He knows what it was like to be mocked, to be beaten, to be shamed in front of everybody because they hung him on a cross. And he willingly allowed himself to be hung on a cross because he loved us and wanted to give us life. He allowed himself to be subjected to trauma so that he could heal us, so that he could give us eternal life, but forgive us of our sins to connect us with God again. That Jesus knows what that's like, and he is beside you and he is beside us every step of the way. I have to cling to that. When it feels like God is not absent, and even Jesus on the cross cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? And that's how it feels when something devastating is happening. But even then, Jesus knew God is there, and Jesus is with us. So if there's something that, if in your life, if you've experienced trauma like that, we have some really good therapists, actually, in our church. We have people who would be willing to listen and care for you. And if something I've said today triggers that, I would love to care for you somehow. And so talk to me afterward. Talk to a woman in the church, maybe, who can help, who would listen and care, because we want to care. Amen? Another voice that we see is the voice of Jacob. And we've been looking at Jacob in our story all along. And Jacob, I would call the voice of indifference. Jacob, we've seen his ups and downs. We've seen successes and failures in his life. And what are we to make of Jacob? When we last saw Jacob, he had just wrestled with God and he had prevailed against God and God had blessed him. He changed his name to Godfighter. And said, I'm going to bless you. And you would think, man, this is this spiritual high. This is this incredible spiritual experience. He's met with God. He's overcome. He's given a new name. He's sent out, like, what possibly could he do bad now from now on? And then we get to this story. And he does nothing. He's so totally indifferent. And at first glance, maybe it doesn't seem like he's the problem. But the fact that he doesn't do anything actually is the problem. How I wish that he would have wept with his daughter. How I wish that he would have gone to his wife, Dinah's mom, Leah, and together they just embraced Dinah and told her, we will stick with you no matter what. We care about you no matter what happened. How I wish that that he would have cried out to God in lament and asked God to avenge. How I wish that he would have pursued whatever legal means he could to bring punishment to this man, to bring justice. I wish he would have empathized. I wish he would stand up to injustice and do it the right way. I wish he would have said to his sons, look, sons, pursue justice, but don't go over the top. Don't go wild on this. Instead, what he does is he protects his image. He does nothing. Look at how it reads, because his indifference is what gets everything started. His indifference when he hears these words of violation, his indifference to the actions of his son. Why was he indifferent? Why was he so passive in the story? The only time he actually speaks is when it gets to the end and he speaks to his sons. And look what it says in verse 30. Because what's he upset about? Is he upset because they spilled innocent blood? Is he upset because she was raped? Is he upset because they've broken God's moral law? Now, here's what he's upset by. He says, you brought trouble on me. If I make him be obnoxious to the Canaanites and the Perizzites, the people living in this land, we don't have that many people. If they join against us, we're toast. He's upset because of how it looks. He's upset because of what we would call peer pressure. He's upset because if they find out, you know, what you did, I'm going to look bad. As we've gone through this whole series, we've seen that Jacob is like a mirror for our souls. And we think to ourselves, we would never experience something so good with God and then be so apathetic toward God. And then we remind ourselves at times, that maybe this is just me, there are times, how many times have you had just this moment with God? And it's a song that you're in worship and it brings you to tears, or you're in your devotion time with God and you just feel like, man, there's such a connection that I'm having with God, and it's amazing that God showed me a word, and that day something happened that was exactly what I needed. I just know that God was with me. Or you've experienced different things like that. And then the second later, like the second you're done with that devotion, the second you walk out of church, you have a lustful thought, or you envy your neighbor, or you get wigged out at the guy who cuts you off in the road, or the person who's sitting next to you in the car, and you just use words that are like, wow, I'm glad they didn't hear that in church. And we just got done experiencing this connection with God. Nobody in this room. Nobody has ever done anything like that. We're at the end of our time, but I don't want to make too big of a deal about this. But Jacob, like, he is the personification of us when we give in to that peer pressure. We just give in to the sense of I know what God wants me to do, because Jacob does know that, and yet I face up to my friends at school, I face up to the people that I work with, I face up to the people in my family that have different way of living, different expectations of me, and I think I'm embarrassed. I don't want to live the faith that I know I should live. I don't want to say the things that might get me ostracized from my friend group, and so I pull back and I'm passive and I'm indifferent. Again, nobody, even as adults, we do that. You know this. So we have to ask ourselves maybe some hard questions out of listening to that voice. Ask ourselves questions like, in my life and in the life of my family, am I pleasing God or am I just trying to fit in? Am I just going along to get along, or am I actually pursuing God with all my heart? Am I entangled in the way with the world in such a way that it's shaping me, or am I allowing God and His Word to shape me in my activities, my attitudes, my actions? Am I choosing cowardice over courage? When I wake up each day, is the beat of my heart to follow Christ, pursue Him with all I have? Or is the beat of my heart to try to get along with people and be liked? We ought to ask ourselves those questions. See, Jacob connects with our life in so many different ways. That's why I'm convinced that this has been a great way to approach the series with Jacob. So if I'm one of the judges on The Voice, I don't want to turn and face the voice of indifference. And then I'll just finish with this. There's one more voice that's not in this passage, but it's in our life, the voice of Jesus. The voice of Jesus is the voice that gives us life. I love all of the ministry of Jesus. I love all the different words that he says, even the ones that are challenging. I love this saying that he gives, this truth that he shares with us in John 14, when he says, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. I am so thankful that Jesus provides a way for us, that despite our own messiness, despite our inconsistencies, despite our lack of integrity, we use the phrase in our confession, our mistakes and our sins. Despite all those things, Jesus is the way of connection with God. He's the way for us to be reunited with God. He is the life. He is the truth of how to live. He connects us with the Father. There's never a time where he says to us, you know what? You've messed up enough. I've given you enough chances. See ya. There's never a time where he says, you know what? I think I'm just about done with you. I'm out of here. There's never a time where he rejects us. There's not a limit to the number of times that he will forgive us. It's not like we come for the 100th time and we say, forgive me. He's like, oh, you've used them all up. You're on your own. He walks with us in the midst of our messiness, and he knows and he says to us, your life is not finished yet. You're not all that I am calling you to, and I'm with you every step of the way. I love that about our Savior. Amen? Father, as we close the service, we've looked at the brutality of life in different facets. And yet now as we sing, we want to sing this song, Turn Your Eyes to Jesus. Because we know that your son Jesus is the voice of life for us. He's the giver of life, abundant and eternal life. And so we want to say in this moment that we recommit ourselves to you. And we sing these words, and I pray that you would help us to live these words each day, that we turn our eyes toward Jesus, the Savior, the giver of life. I pray that in Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand and sing that great song together. When you're on the beach in Sanibel Island, you see destruction, gutted building one after another. There are pockets of restoration. There are pockets of rebuilding. There are restaurants that are beginning to be opened. There's construction that's going on. And that just seems like a good metaphor in some way. When we live in this devastated world, devastated by sin, that we've participated in, we are part of that reconstruction project that Jesus is working on our hearts. He's working on our lives. He's bringing healing, and that brings hope to all who are around who see. And so today as you leave, I want to give you a benediction, a blessing. May you leave knowing that you are being reconstructed by our Savior, this hope of the world, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Have a great day, everybody.